We here at the Sports History Network proudly partner with 26 podcasts, all revolving around the history of sports. But did you know that many of our hosts were sports history authors way before they started their shows? It's true. We've got Joe Ziemba, host of When Football Was Football. Joe Zagurski, host of Pro Football in the 1970s. Mark Morthier, host of Yesterday Sports. Tommy Phillips, host of Lombardi Memories. And Scott Adamson, co-host of From the 55-Yard Line. All these authors have many books for you to choose from. To check them out, go to our website at sportshistorynetwork.com/sportshistorybooks. Pick up your copy today! Soundtrack provided by Kevin MacLeod of filmmusic.io.
This podcast is part of the Sports History Network, your headquarters for the yesteryear of your favorite sport. You can learn more at sportshistorynetwork.com.
At the beginning of the roaring 20s, the world was at a crossroads. An entire generation of men in Europe, and to some extent North America, had been devastated by the Great War, now known as World War I, and the so-called Spanish flu pandemic. Additionally, events in dozens of countries resulted in leadership changes, new intrastate alliances, and whole new political systems. In Russia, the Bolsheviks ran out the monarchy in the name of Karl Marx's call to the proletariat. In China, the transition from 2,000 years of imperial rule to a republican government unifying the provinces was ongoing. And the Paris Peace Conference, which formally ended World War I, also resulted in the idealistic League of Nations, the world's first truly international governmental organization. Despite the overwhelming fatigue of international conflict and the incoming decade of relative peacefulness of the 1920s, however, another war was brewing. War of the sexes in the struggle for women's equality. Between 1917 and 1929, some 37 countries granted women the right to vote, though some countries, such as Australia, Canada, the US, and Rhodesia, limited these rights for native women or even non-white people. The 1920s were also a boom time for sport. The Olympics returned after the previous games had been canceled due to the war, and international test cricket resumed with the 20th playing of the Ashes between Australia and England in 1920. That same year, the National Football League was born, albeit under a different name, as was the Negro National Baseball League. And by 1930, the first Soccer World Cup had been organized. But just as significant as any of these events, was the revelation that, hey, women could play sport at the highest levels as well. Alice Josephine Marie Milliat, a French woman, doubtlessly inspired by the efforts of her countryman Pierre de Coubertin in the previous century to resurrect the ancient Olympic Games, leveraged her status as the founder and head of the Fédération Française Sportive Féminine to get meetings with the International Olympic Committee in the teens. The IOC turned down Milliat's proposals to put women's track and field events in the 1924 Olympics, and so she formed her own competition, the 1921 Women's Olympiad in Monte Carlo. 100 athletes from France, Italy, Switzerland, and the United Kingdom competed in 10 events. Though virtually ignored in North American media, the Games captured Europe's imagination enough to lead to the formation of the quadrennial Women's World Games in 1922. And half a world away, certainly paying attention, was one exceptional young woman, a 15-year-old wunderkind who would go on to become a national hero, an international feminist icon, a pioneer in sports writing, and perhaps Japan's greatest female athlete of all time. Her name was Kinue Hitomi, and her brilliant athletic career is topped only by her ultimate influence on her nation's culture and the tragically expansive country of what might have been.
My name is Oz Davis, and this is Truly the Goats, sports history as told through its superstars.
Madame Milliot's efforts with the IOC ultimately proved to have not been entirely in vain. Increasing participation and interest in the Women's World Games, plus, pragmatically speaking, Milliot's refusal at first to remove Olympic from her game's name, the committee promised the inclusion of 10 track and field events for women at the 1928 Olympic Games. As in Japan's Edo period of the 17th to 19th centuries, leadership saw sport as a crucial aspect of culture, and in the young 20th century, culture could serve as a catapult to international prestige. An early test of this assertion came in 1926, when Kinue Hitomi participated in the Women's World Games as a one-woman team for Japan. All she did at those games was win 2 golds, 1 silver, and 1 bronze medal, thus bagging more medals in individual sports than the entire Czechoslovakian team, and falling 1 shy of matching the home team Sweden total. The stage was set for Hitomi, already breaking ground in Japan as the country's first ever female sports writer, and a generation of Japanese athletes to wow the world from Amsterdam at the 1928 Olympic Games. For episode 4 of Truly the Goats on the all-time greats and history of Japan's national sport of sumo wrestling, I was fortunate enough to be joined by Dr. Dennis Frost, Director of East Asian Studies at Kalamazoo College in Michigan, and author of 2 books, More Than Medals, A History of the Paralympics and Disability Sports in Postwar Japan, and Seeing Stars, Sports Celebrity, Identity, and Body Culture in Modern Japan. Dennis was the one who turned my attention to the story of Kinue Hitomi and suggested that she'd make an excellent subject for Truly the Goats, particularly in reference to one of the show's major obsessions, namely Babe Didrikson Zaharias. But the delayed 2020 Tokyo Olympics, now running in 2021, I could think of no better time than to tell the story of this world shifter of an athlete. And no one better to guest than Dr. Dennis Frost. Dennis Frost, welcome back to Truly the Goats.
Thanks for having me back. It's a pleasure.
The last time we spoke on Truly the Goats, we talked a lot about the Edo period, the 17th to 19th centuries in Japan, the peak of which was the heyday of the great sumo wrestler Hakuho. We also spoke quite a bit about whatever they're going to call this crazy century.
Yeah.
Hopefully they don't call it the end times, but whatever they call it. So we talked about that. But today we're going to talk about Hitomi Kinue, who is growing up in a historically distinct and, again, significant time period in Japan. So tell us a little bit about this era in the 20s and 30s.
So yeah, Hitomi is she's a fascinating figure in many respects. She comes of age at a moment where Western sports have been introduced in Japan. About, you know, they're introduced in the late 1800s, and so they've been kind of they're beginning to be established. But sports for women are still very, very new. And so there's a lot of different sports that are being introduced. Baseball is already, by that point, is actually already pretty popular. You know, it's spreading to middle schools and high schools and all over Japan. But again, sports for women are something that is not very common. At the same time, this is also a moment where you're starting to see more and more women's activism. So you're seeing more and more women get involved in issues of politics. There's a women's suffrage movement that kicks off around this time in Japan. You're seeing more and more women coming into the workforce. So this is a really fascinating moment in terms of kind of the historical changes that are happening for women and lots of other people, of course, in Japan at this point in time.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because it seems like, first, I don't believe that a lot of people in the West would just jump to that conclusion that, yeah, a woman like Kinue can get a job as a sports writer, mm-hmm. no less, and that she could be on this very high level of competition. Again, like mm-hmm. you said, a lot of games are coming out at this time for women as well on the international yeah. scene. But Japan in particular, especially with the women's athletes, they appear on the scene just suddenly and instantly are among the tops. Mm-hmm. How much of this is based on that sort of nationalistic thing that we kind of saw in the Edo period as well, where like sports is a cultural lever, mm-hmm. especially as we're getting into this international age? How much of it is that?
So I definitely think that's part of the story and part of her story in particular, because she does become arguably, you know, one of the things I've talked about in writing about her is that she becomes, I think, one of the most famous sports figures of her era, like more famous than many of the men she's like contemporaries with. And part of that is that she is so successful on the international stage that she is, you know, she's sometimes referred to in Japanese as the world's Hitomi. She's Japan's Hitomi, you know, and Hitomi, again, that's her family name. So they're just talking about her like in the sense of like everybody knows who she is. And it was this sense, I think, very much tied to an interest in kind of Japan trying to demonstrate that it had joined the international crowd. And one example of that is women's sports. And, you know, and in some ways, Japan is leading. I mean, she won several, you know, had world records and things like that. And that was pretty unique at that moment. Like you said, you know, in some ways, it feels like if you're looking at this tennis historically, it almost comes out of nowhere. There's no Japanese competitors. And then it's like, boom, all of a sudden you have this, you know, one of the world's best athletes emerge seemingly out of nowhere.
And wow, burst onto the scene she did. At the 1928 Olympic Games, the first with women's track and field events, Hitomi once again comprised the entirety of Japan's women's team. She won a silver medal at the 800 meters, losing by a sliver to Germany's Carolina Radke, who set a record in that race. But the international media attention Hitomi received was pure gold. A representative piece during those Olympics ran in the Washington, D.C. Evening Star, entitled, "Kimi Hitomi, Not Only Sports Star, But She Is Some Girl." The article reads in part, "The Japanese sent only one woman to represent them in the women's games, but she is some girl. Kimi Hitomi, 20-year-old wonder girl from Osaka, is a track team all by herself. A few weeks ago in England, Miss Hitomi established a women's world record in the broad jump at 18 feet 4 inches. She was beaten last Saturday at Stamford Bridge, London, by Miss Gum, the British girl athlete who set a new world record of 18 feet 7 inches. But on the same day, Miss Hitomi equaled the world record for women in the 200-yard dash, doing 25 4/5 seconds flat. But even if she does not win in any event, she is a remarkable girl. Many of the female athletes here have amazing athletic prowess, but little else. Miss Hitomi, attired in a soft gray-green suit, sitting among the men members of her team while they played billiards in their hotel, impressed this writer as one of the most magnetic personalities he had ever encountered. She does not chew gum, nor does she try to look, nor act like a man. Not even on the track in her funny little black-knitted sweatsuit." Negri Farson for the Washington Star and the Chicago Daily News, July 30, 1928. Hitomi remained a fixture on sports pages worldwide. When she broke the record for the 200-meter dash at the All-Japan Track and Field event in Tokyo in 1929, news outlets all over America reported the achievement with headlines like,
"Japanese girl smashes world track standard."
The next world for Hitomi to conquer would be at the 1930 Women's World Games. Because the IOC reneged on the promise they'd made to Madame Billiot and her FSFI, sanctioning only 5 women's track and field events rather than the 10 of the initial bargain, this separate women's event continued. The women's games had doubled in number of participants from 100 to over 200 in the past 8 years, and competing nations had more than tripled from 5 to 17. 12 track and field events were held, and some 5 other games, basketball and handball among them, figuring in the exhibition as well. As for Japan, this time Hitomi had teammates. The Japanese team numbered 6. Hitomi was the only non-high school, non-collegian of the lot, and she would participate in 7 events, while her teammates were slated for 3 or 4. Kinue came away with all 4 of Team Japan's medals from that event, one in such disparate events as the 60 meters, the long jump, the javelin, and a triathlon of 3 track and field sports. Directly after the 1930 games in Prague, Hitomi and her teammates traveled to compete at a 2-nation track meet in Poland against another new international sensation, the American resident / Polish citizen Stanisława Walasewicz, aka Stella Walsh. Walsh carried her record-setting 100-meter win at the AAU Track and Field Championships earlier that year by winning 3 golds and a bronze at the Women's World Games, including in the 60 meters against Hitomi. At the Poland meet, Stella won 2 events and Kinue won. Team Poland won in the scoring, 55-38, but no matter. Kinue Hitomi's international superstar status and the new respect Japan's athletes were gaining on the world stage continued to grow. In an article running in the Kansas City Star in November 1930 entitled, Japanese Girl Called Greatest Athlete, the uncredited writer readily bestows upon Hitomi a certain title, then much more rarely used than today. The newspapers of London quite generally spoke of her as the world's greatest woman athlete, says the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. Miss Kinue Hitomi had just come from the third meet of the Women's World Games at Prague, where she was captain of the Japanese team, and, if anything could have broken the Eastern Reserve to the extent of catching her to blush, it would have been the showers of adjectives poured upon her sleeked, bobbed head. The Manchester Guardian spoke of her as undoubtedly the greatest girl athlete the world has ever seen, and that is going back to the time when Greece and Rome had athletic contests for women similar to those for men. But the English sports writers cite a long series of records to support the claims they make for Miss Hitomi. She holds the world's 100-meter record of 12.2 seconds jointly, the world's 200-meter record of 24.7 seconds, the world's broad jump record of 19 feet 11.1 inches, and the world's triathlon record. It is difficult to believe, confronting the records of Miss Hitomi and the other Japanese contestants, men and women in international athletic contests, that it was only 18 years ago that Japan first sent a team to the Olympic Games, a team that participated, and that was about all. From the first, Japan apparently realized that native excellence alone could not make up for the long delay in entering the international sports arena. Miss Hitomi was captain of the team of six girls, most of them between 17 and 20 years of age, who took part in the women's games at Prague recently. There she won the broad jump at 19 feet 4.2 inches. When she is not in athletic competition in some part of the world or another, Miss Hitomi is on the staff the Japanese newspaper Osaka Mainichi, and it is said that, unlike most athletes, she does her own writing without aid of the American device of a ghostwriter. She attributes Japan's athletic prowess during the past 10 years to the keenness of the boys and girls who are given a thorough athletic education in their most impressionable years. Let's talk about that iconic status. From the outside, it seems like celebrities and franchise characters are even bigger in the public consciousness in Japan. Figures become almost larger than life. Back then, does this sort of thing exist? And do the women's athletes of Japan have this sort of pull?
That's a good question. And my sense is that not all of them do. That, you know, like you said, she is part of a kind of this broader movement of women that are kind of emerging on this the domestic Japanese sports scene, but also kind of competing internationally. But most of them don't get the same degree of attention that Hitomi does. And again, part of that is just she's more successful. Like you said, she wins the medals. You know, it's her winning these team medals. And I think that's a big part of it. But she was everywhere. You know, it was one of those things where she shows up in cartoons, in these cartoon magazines that were produced at the time. So there's like cartoons kind of making fun of her and praising her, kind of a mix a lot of times. And there's also she shows up, like you said, in the media. She's all over the media. She was also very prolific herself. She wrote several books and published them. And she gave speaking tours and so was traveling all over the place. So in some ways, you know, she was more prominent, I think, partly because of what she wanted to do and partly because she saw herself very intentionally as someone that was out there kind of as a pioneer, kind of breaking new ground for women. And so she wanted to kind of go out there and do this. So she made herself in some ways larger than life.
At year's end, 1930, international sports fans had to be in equal parts amazed at the present and excited for the future. In fewer than 10 years, organized international women's sport had gone from occasional curiosity to regularly scheduled world-class headline-grabbing spectacle under the auspices of the FSFI. Thanks in no small part to the rising stars in track and field, women's sport had gone from nearly zero to golden age in one decade flat. Better yet for those fans was the certain perception that the best was yet to come, namely at the 1932 Olympic Games. Hitomi would once again be there to challenge Walsh in the sprints, and those deeply in the know about athletics may have already been penciling in a newcomer to the sport who'd recently led her team to three consecutive AAU basketball championships, Babe Didrikson. Whatever the result, the 100 meters at the 1932 Olympics alone already looked like instant history, an all-time classic in the making. But it just wasn't to be, for Hitomi was about to face the one opponent she couldn't beat. We'll get back to the Truly the Goats podcast in just a moment. But first, I'd like to take a minute to tell you about quite possibly the greatest website of all time, newspapers.com. If you're listening to this podcast or any of them at the Sports History Network, you're probably into sports history. And you probably also know that for learning about anything prior to, say, 1990 online, the typical search engines like are nearly completely useless. But then there's newspapers.com. Newspapers.com gives you access to over 640 million pages worth of news from North America, Britain, Ireland, and more, dating from 1798 to last week. Do up a search for Super Bowl I, the 36th Berlin Olympics, Wayne Gretzky's first game, whatever. Newspapers.com takes you there with historical flavor that search engines like just don't give you. And now, get a free one-week subscription to Newspapers.com by visiting sportshistorynetwork.com/newspapers. With a paid subscription, you'll also be helping to support the production of Myth Podcast and other Sports History Network shows. That's sportshistorynetwork.com/newspapers. Newspapers.com. Way better for searches than you know what I'm talking about.
At the Sports History Network, we're all about sports yesteryear, and so we're so pleased to introduce you to Row One, an online memorabilia gallery and shop that brings your sports history to life anywhere. The Row One gallery includes over 5,200 gorgeously reproduced prints of team posters, game program covers, game tickets, advertisements, and more in baseball, pro and college football, pro and college basketball, and more. And any gallery item may be printed in a variety of sizes on wood, metal, canvas, acrylic, or poster paper. And in Row One shop, check out the thousands more of unique items with a retro and historical designs dating back to 1876, including t-shirts, long sleeve shirts, phone cases, mugs, blankets, pillows, towels, and even shower curtains. Go to sportshistorynetwork.com, ROW number one, for access to the full Row One catalog and for gallery prints and gift items. Plus, get a 15% discount off all prints on the Row One Pictorum Gallery with coupon code SHN15. Follow the link on the show notes.
The downside to acting as any type of social innovator, revolutionary even, is the backlash one is certain to face. And Kinue Hitomi was no exception whatsoever. In a society rife with traditional values like Japan, novelty can easily agitate the old school. Short, not quite everyone back home in Japan was as thrilled by the girl wonder as were foreign sports writers. I've read that there was negative backlash to Kinue. Can you explain that to me? Was there this sort of backlash?
Definitely. And I mean, it's of course not unique to Japan. I mean, some of the names you mentioned faced exactly the same thing in other contexts. And so it's hardly surprising that we're seeing something similar happening in Japan in that sense. But yeah, there was definitely kind of, you know, people who were conservative arguing that, like, you know, it's unfeminine for women to be out there competing in these sports. There were people who were critical because in some ways, because she was showing up the men, because she's winning international medals and achieving international success and the Japanese men are not doing that. So there's people that are kind of criticizing that aspect. There was, you know, also critiques of why isn't she married? That was like a question that she often would get asked. And in fact, one of her last articles she wrote was an article kind of complaining essentially about all these people asking this question of why aren't you married yet? And you know, and so there was lots of kind of things like that. But again, this is also part of this moment where there's a lot of women that are kind of choosing different options. They're deciding to, you know, go into the workforce and maybe wait to get married. So that's, she's part of this broader kind of social development and this, what's often referred to in Japanese as kind of the woman problem, the Fujimondai, as the Japanese phrase for this. So it's something that's being talked about, and she kind of becomes part of this in the sports side. And there was also lots of kind of discussion around her sexuality, her gender. There was some people that were really cruel. And the same thing, you saw this, you know, I think Babe Didrikson had some of the same experiences in other contexts.
Whatever Kinue thought of her detractors, she had no intention of slowing down in either her athletic or professional career, nor even in her new role as a public figure. The Poland meet, directly following the Women's Games in 1930, was chased up in turn directly thereafter by events in Berlin, Brussels, Paris, and London, when she and her team finally arrived back in Japan in October, Kinue started giving talks at women's colleges and making public appearances throughout the country, in addition to staying in training and filing stories with the Mainichi. But by late March, she was checked into an Osaka hospital. 3 months later, under a tight veil of privacy and secrecy, Kinue Hitomi was dead of pneumonia. She was just 24 years old.
Because she died early, and you know, one of the things I've talked about a little bit is that she sparked this kind of movement around sports medicine. There was kind of criticism of like, how did she get to the point where she was so unhealthy? You know, as this elite, supposedly health, super healthy athlete, how does she get to the point where she died suddenly? So there's lots of different critiques that pop up depending on kind of the area of society that their people are coming from.
I was going to ask that. How does she die so suddenly from pneumonia in the 20th century?
Well, and we still don't know, right? We still don't, because there was never an actual autopsy done. And so the suspicion is that she actually maybe had tuberculosis, or she just developed like some sort of chronic lung infection. The tuberculosis, wouldn't be uncommon, you know, at that point in time. It was kind of one of the most common diseases in Japan. And lots of other places too, of course. But the fact that she would have caught it suggests, you know, how does an athlete, you know, who's healthy and running and active, doing all this. And a big part of this is that overwork is often what a lot of people said, is that she essentially in some ways kind of worked herself to death through training and all these lecture tours and things like that. She just wouldn't stop and take a break and rest and recover. And so, you know, there was signs even when she was on her last tour in Europe that she was not very healthy and was already starting to struggle. And then, you know, about a year later, she passes away.
What was the effect of Kinue's death in Japan? And maybe much more importantly, what has been her influence on culture and sport since that time passing? I mean, you mentioned sports medicine.
Yeah. I mean, and it's really rich. And that was part of, you know, one of the other things that I really enjoyed digging into her story is that when I first started looking at this, I would mention her name to people and they would say, oh yeah, I know who that is, because I saw a documentary about her in Japan, of course. And because every time the Olympics happen, her story gets kind of replayed. And, you know, and when you have a female athlete in Japan, particularly a track and field athlete who wins some medal, her story often kind of comes back and kind of, and so there's a way in which, you know, partly because she's like got that pioneer status, partly because, you know, when people win medals, they often like, who are the earlier medal winners and things like that. So I think she's had kind of a long-term impact, you know, that continues. And a lot of the track and field athletes from the 80s and 90s kind of refer to her and reference her as kind of somebody that they kind of held up as kind of a role model, which is really interesting because that was, you know, 50, 60 years before many of them were really active. And so that's kind of fascinating to see that. And she was kind of for a long time, the last kind of major Japanese female athlete who was competing and winning medals at the Olympics. So part of that is that, you know, the Olympics, they got complicated. You know, they didn't run the 800 where she won her first medal at the Olympics, you know, which is one of the ones she's most famous for. Then the 800 wasn't run for another, I think, what, 40 years or something. Part of the issue is that women were in a different status and kind of the categories were different and things like that. But it's also, you know, I think her death did, like I said, triggered all this kind of discussion about sports medicine. For the critics, it was kind of the perfect ammunition. They could say like, well, look, see, we were right. Women shouldn't be doing these kinds of things. There you got pushback because, you know, the other piece of the story, and this is something that a lot of people don't always talk about, but is that this was tied to eugenics. The eugenics movement was very much tied to women's sports. Like the idea of healthy mothers, having healthy women that can become healthy mothers, produce healthy children. And there was a lot of the people promoting sports were tied to the eugenics movement. And so they were trying to counter this idea that, you know, it's dangerous for women to compete internationally. So there's kind of this after her death, and there's kind of all these different kind of moving pieces. You get the critics and the counter critics and these people kind of that are pushing women's sports for, you know, the sport's sake and for women's sake. And then there's the eugenicists that are pushing it for that particular element. You know, so it's a really kind of fascinating kind of mix of all these different moments. And like I said, it was a fascinating period in Japanese history. One of my favorite periods to look at is something that's called the interwar period, the period between World War I and World War II, when Japan really is just, its sports scene is booming. And the fact that you get this really kind of famous athlete that everybody at the time knows and that she continues to be known and continues to be kind of problematic, because of her death, because of these questions that were generated around sexuality and things like that, that they never kind of got addressed. And this kind of keeps coming back. And so it's a big part of the story. So yeah, so she's just really, really fascinating and an amazing athlete. I mean, right. Must have been kind of, I wish I could have seen it. I've never got to see any footage of her. I did look for it, like desperately hunted for actual footage of her competing. There's supposed to be some, but I never was able to find it myself.
In the 21st century, the Olympic Games are not looked upon with the same reverence, respect, and interest as they once were. They no longer evoke the excitement and wonder. In the lead-up to the Games, one may find just as commonly as stories of the athletes themselves, the stories of corruption amongst Olympic officials, of doping scandals, of the environmental toll taken by massive, hastily built construction projects. Maybe this admiration of the Games is something vital that we've lost to neoliberal internationalism, and that would be a shame. Because the story of Kinue Hitomi reminds us of just what this grandest of all sports spectacles can be about. The chance for entire nations to proudly show their best and brightest on peaceful, politically neutral ground. And the chance for the individual to break the barriers set before us from a time long since past, and to be remembered for all time. This has been Truly the Goats, a Sports History Network podcast. To find us online, visit trulythegoats.com. On Twitter and Facebook, we're at Truly the Goats. For more like-minded shows, be sure to check out sportshistorynetwork.com. Like the man says, it's
your headquarters for the yesteryear of your favorite sport.
Truly the Goats thanks our guest for this episode.
It's Dr. Dennis Frost of Kalamazoo College. Dennis's latest book, More Than Medals, is available from Cornell University Press at cornellpress.cornell.edu. His book, Seeing Stars, which includes material on Kinue Hitomi, is available from Harvard University Press at hup.harvard.edu. And of course, both are available through the usual online outlets for books as well. The Truly the Goats theme song is Fun on Street, greatest remix of all time, and is produced by David Liso of Dynamo Stairs. Music used in this episode includes Cuban Moon by Carl Fenton's Orchestra, Crazy Blues by Mamie Smith, and Street Life by Lobo Loco. This last track is available by free use agreement via freemusicarchive.org. This is Oz Davis for Truly the Goats and the Sports History Network saying, always keep perspective.
At the Sports History Network, we're all about sports yesteryear, and so we're so pleased to introduce you to Row One, an online memorabilia gallery and shop that brings your sports history to life anywhere. The Row One Gallery includes over 5,200 gorgeously reproduced prints of team posters, game program covers, game tickets, advertisements, and more in baseball, pro and college football, pro and college basketball, and more. And any gallery item may be printed in a variety of sizes on wood, metal, canvas, acrylic, or poster paper. And in Row One Shop, check out the thousands more of unique unique items with a retro and historical designs dating back to 1876, including t-shirts, long-sleeve shirts, phone cases, mugs, blankets, pillows, towels, and even shower curtains. Go to sportshistorynetwork.com, ROW number one, for access to the full Row 1 catalog and for gallery prints and gift items, plus get a 15% discount off all prints on the Row 1 Pictorum Gallery with coupon code SHN15. Follow the link on the show notes.